watching Primetime. I'm Tamanna Namdar.
And my name is Ayush Alavadi. Let's have a look at today's top stories. Interim Finance Minister Piyush Goyal sets up a panel to decide on an asset reconstruction company for faster resolution of stressed assets.
RIL's Chairman and Managing Director Mukesh Amani bets big on consumer businesses becoming a major contributor on par with its energy and materials business. Is the stage set for an IPO for RIL's consumer business?
U-turn from the Haryana government puts the notification asking athletes under the state government to give one-third of their earnings to the government on hold after receiving a lot of flack.
Markets end with gains for the third straight week. Both the Nifty and Sensex post weekly gains over 0.5%.
And it's Donald Trump versus the rest at the G7 meeting, which begins today. US tariffs on EU and Canada, the stance on a climate deal, and the Iran Accord are likely to dominate the agenda of the summit.
Well, let's get on to the top story of the day. In a bid to accelerate resolutions of stressed accounts, Interim Finance Minister Piyush Goyal has announced setting up of a committee. The panel will give a recommendation to the Finance Ministry within 2 weeks on the formation of an asset reconstruction company. Basically, it seems like the bad bank idea is back. Now, after meeting heads of PSU banks, Goyal did say that the government is standing firmly behind all 21 public sector banks.
Over the next 2 weeks, will come out with their recommendations of a suggestion that was deliberated in great detail amongst the bankers today, who believe that it may be worth considering to set up an asset reconstruction company and or an asset management company for faster resolution of stressed assets which have multiple banks involved in these accounts and often which get delayed in resolution and cause loss of value to the banking system as a whole.
The key decision is about improving the flow of credit to the accounts, which are good accounts and under consortium and multiple entity. Flow of credit to MSMEs. How do they get credit in timely manner? Third is about how do we segregate the NPAs and whether there can be an AMC, ARC, which is especially set up, or usse jo hai, jo management's ki bandwidth hai, usko dur kiya jaye. और चौथा जो इशू है कि जो रिस्क गवर्नेंस स्ट्रक्चर है बैंक्स का उसमें एक दूसरे से क्या लर्न कर सकते और एक इशू जो है कि बैंक को जो है अगर आज अपनी जो अर्थव्यवस्था है पूरा जो सपना है कि हम एक विश्व की बड़ी अर्थव्यवस्था बने तो बड़े बैंकों के बिना बड़ी अर्थव्यवस्था नहीं बन सकती.
Well, obviously, these announcements were made earlier today, and Vishwanath Nair was at the event. Vishwanath joins us now. Now, this idea of forming this committee for stressed assets, it seems a little bit like a case of deja vu. Is the bad bank notion back?
So, you know, the bad bank discussion originally started with Viral Acharya, the Deputy Governor of the Reserve Bank of India, putting out a speech. And as part of the speech, he suggested creating something known as a National Asset Management Company, which would house these bad loans, and it would be a government led sort of discussion. And the discussion took place back then, but then it never really went anywhere, and then it just closed down. After that, this topic has been discussed on and off, but never really took off as a potential idea that could resolve the bad loans in a decisive manner. So to that effect, yes, it's a deja vu, because we're sort of repeating the same ideas again. To that effect, this ARC or an AMC type of structure, as is being proposed at this point in time, would house these bad assets, hold them, try to turn them around, potentially sell them. But of course, all of this is part of the terms of mandate of a committee that is formed under the Punjab National Bank non-executive chairman, Sunil Mehta, who will be sitting with some of his compatriots, discussing it and see if there is a need for such a company at all. And once he's arrived at that decision, the committee can then discuss the modalities under which this can be formed. Of course, all of this is at this point in time in a very initial stage, and there is no firm decision making on it. Yeah. But considering that the government is coming back to the topic, it's interesting.
It's also interesting looking at the steps which have been taken since the first time bad banks were in news and there was buzz about them. Well, Abizer Diwanji, partner and national leader financial services at EY, joins us now for his take on it. Thank you so much, Mr. Diwanji, for speaking with us. Why do you think that the government seems to be coming back to the idea of an AMC or ARC to ease the stressed asset problem?
So once this issue around the bad bank has been debated on and off for a number of years, actually. And I think that the key issue which was stopping back the government was the fact that there is a moral hazard of actually trying to put assets in a company, the sole objective of which is to liquidate it for cash. And hence, that is where the decision-making was kind of wavering. But looking at how it has been done internationally, I think it seems to be the best way to actually release out capital from banks. And if you look at it, banks today have locked up a lot of their capital in bad loans, and unless somebody aggregates the bad loans and sell it as a single decision-maker, we are seeing that this process has been dragged along for a long time. So I think all in all, after a due consideration, they seem to have thought that the bad bank or a similar concept, I won't say it's not been defined as a bad bank, something similar is a good concept. They may decide to house A asset in A bank for A resolution also. I think the idea is aggregation as against creating a legal structure.
Mr. Diwanji, Vishwanath here joining this conversation. Just wanted to, you know, firstly throw this off that the initial discussions sort of petered off because the conversation was that the government should not be leading resolutions because it becomes a bit of a political quagmire, and then you end up in debate on whether the government should be be involved in this decision making at all. So to that effect, this current announcement comes as some sort of opposite to that idea originally.
No, so you're assuming today that the government will effectively force resolution. What it may actually do is that they may actually put good professionals in who would actually do a good job at selling those assets. They may put a bunch of investment bankers, resolution professionals, etc. in there who are not controlled by the government, but the government has a shareholding, of course. So that could also happen. It could be that the right skill set may be brought into a new structure. It could well be that it may just aggregate it within one particular bank, say, okay, I will aggregate all of X SR steel, for example, with State Bank. That may also happen. I think the aim here is about aggregation and then selling, with the aim to quickly release capital in banks' balance sheets. So we'll have to see how the structure evolves. We're kind of second-guessing a bad bank.
No, sure. I just your sense on how it would compare to the current process we are seeing of trying to resolve some of these stressed assets. The IBC is being tested almost on a daily basis. Do you think that the ARC/AMC idea is back because of the hurdles, the legal bumps that the current process has been facing?
So the current process faces two or three large issues, and we can see how that can be addressed by this bank. So one issue is the fact that exposures are spread across various banks. So today, on an average, we have between 15 and 20 banks per exposure. If that came down to one or two, maybe, that will expedite decision-making significantly. Point number two is that there is this issue around CVC and that the bankers actually face. And those issues, frankly, can be countered if there is an empowerment to a particular entity to just deal with these assets. Now, I raised the issue around moral hazard, and that has to be addressed well in terms of a better committee and an oversight and all that stuff. And frankly, if we can have the right oversight, we can do it. The third issue is the real competence, whether our bankers really have the competence to resolve assets. Overall, globally also, resolution of assets is not a core competency of bankers. So here you're trying to create a specialist entity which has resolution skills, and that may change. So I think if we can achieve these three broad pillars, which have always been an issue in terms of dragging the process down, this would help.
Okay, we have with us Mr. R.K. Bansal, former IDBI banker, and also the currently with Edelweiss ARC. Mr. Bansal, just your initial thoughts on this bad bank idea or an asset management company idea coming back into the discussion. Do you think that this could see the light of day?
See, this idea has been discussed, I think, a number of times earlier. But now perhaps it is coming back mainly because of power sector stress. So I feel if government is keen and if there is a warehousing capability in the this AMC or ARC, whatever, and then somebody has to provide funds, of course, it can work. Hello?
Yes, Mr. Bansal. Mr. Bansal, also an important question that needs to be asked here is you know, ARCEL already exists. You know, such a structure already exists with bank contribution, and it has been in, you know, the employees there have been dealing with resolution for a very long time now. Why not just use that structure, and why create this new structure altogether?
No, that way, see, already there are so many ARCs in the country, and they have been capitalized by different entities. When banks have promoted some of them. And banks themselves have capacity to actually to resolve the asset. But as Abizer was saying, I think the issue is there are too many entities. So if that debt is acquired at one place, that is the advantage of the ARC structure, that you can aggregate the debt and find a resolution at one place. The challenge basically with any structure is, unless it's owned by government and government gives some comfort, there are two challenges. One is the valuation, the second is again capital. So if somehow we cross these two and banks are okay with valuation, then please provide either effort to their means, right?
All right. Thank you so much, R.K. Bansal and Abizer Diwanji, for speaking to us on this subject. Now, let's move on to the next story. Reliance Industries may be looking at listing its consumer business. That's the key takeaway from the latest annual report. Not that Group Chairman Mukesh Ambani spelt it out in his message to shareholders, but there were some clear hints thrown in. And Sajit Mangat has been trying to look for those hints and reading between the lines. Sajit, please take us through the details.
You know, the annual report came out yesterday for the shareholders, and in the letter to the shareholders, what Ms. Ambani has clearly written is that its consumer businesses, which is Reliance Retail and Reliance Jio, have attained threshold, which means that they are now at a point in time when they're going to contribute significantly to the profitability of the Reliance Group's balance sheet. And that's something which is an indication, because in the past, when shareholders have asked Mr. Ambani about when they plan to, you know, monetize or take these companies public, he has always given an answer saying that they are still in an investment phase and they need to reach a threshold before such a thing can happen. And now it seems that they are there, because both the companies together have a revenue of nearly $14 billion, which is a huge amount, and both are now profitable. And going into FY19, they're expected to have a strong growth, revenue growth and profitability. And this is something which is resonant to with what Ambani had been saying, that this thing will happen of monetizing or for going public, once the threshold is reached. And a couple of months back, even Bloomberg wrote a story about how Ambani's are looking, or Reliance is looking at bankers for its IPO, for its Reliance Jio. So this is something which is in the works now, and hopefully when the AGM happens on July 5th, and Ambani is likely to come out and give some kind of guidance on where he wants to take these two businesses.
So, Jeet, you've been tracking the space for a while now, but when it comes to Reliance Jio, we've all seen how it's disrupted the telecom space. But considering how things are moving so fast in that space, is it too soon to have these talks? Are we rushing into it in terms of going public?
Well, you know, from a revenue point of view, it is a big business, because both of them together amounts to nearly $14 billion. $10 billion is the revenue for Reliance Retail, and roughly around $3.6 billion is for Reliance Jio. And Reliance Jio's operation has been part for this last financial year. So the full year operations is something which is going to be in FY19. And given the kind of growth which it has shown, it's likely that it will have a top line of $8 to $10 billion by the end of the year. So what we are looking at is that if Reliance Retail doubles again in FY19, which they have been talking about in its annual report that they have very aggressive plans, then we are looking at both the consumer businesses to be in the region of $20 to $25 billion in revenue, and contributing in EBITDA as well as profitability for for the Reliance Industries. And that is something which is a good threshold for a company to come into the market and get a good valuation. And so it's good for the shareholders as well, because roughly 2.5 lakh crore of investment has gone into Jio, and more than 50,000 crore or more of that has gone into retail as well. So it's going to be something like, you know, getting the returns out of these investments,
right,
which would be up on the agenda for the management as well.
Right, Suji, thanks so much for that analysis. Now, India's richest man, Mukesh Ambani, hasn't gotten a pay hike in a decade. But that's not the number you should really be focusing on. Ambani's dividend gives you the right picture of his payslip. Have a look. And moving on, a draft law on data privacy drafted by prominent lawyers like Apar Gupta, Gautam Bhatia and Kritika Bhardwaj, to name a few, was submitted to the Justice Shri Krishna-led Committee on Data Privacy today. The draft law is a result of a campaign called Save Our Privacy and focuses not just on data protection, but also user privacy and surveillance. Arpan Chaturvedi has more details in this report.
Well, in this model law, basically, the group of citizens, lawyers and policy analysts that they have come up with, they have discussed a range of issues like basically what is the meaning of consent when it applies to majors, adults above the age of 18, what does it mean for minors, and once they attain the age of majority after that, what happens to the consent that they had given to data protection, how much can the government interfere as far as the collection of data is concerned. Apart from that, they've also come up with a provision where they have said that the government cannot deny anyone essential services if they choose not to withdraw or part with their data, because they said that amounts to effectively consent by coercion. So that has been some of the areas that's been discussed. The model also calls for setting up of a privacy commission which will regulate and protect citizens' rights. They also talk about that strengthening the existing laws such as the RTI Act to ensure that the citizens' privacy and data rights are protected. Apart from that, they've also dealt on the issue of jurisdiction, which basically means that entities which are not operating in India but are collecting data of Indian citizens and have presence in India, that also should be covered under the right to privacy law. And all these suggestions, of course, have been submitted to Justice B.N. Shri Krishna Committee, which, as we know, has been tasked by the government to come up with a draft data protection law. And what we learn as of now is that this month, which is June, the Shri Krishna Committee will be submitting the first draft of the data framework.
Well, the Haryana government today put out a notification asking athletes to pay a part of their earnings to the state sports body, 33% actually. The move came in from sharp criticism from athletes as well on social media. And while the state's sports minister supported the notification, the government finally put it on hold after a barrage of criticism.
One-third of the income which the players derived is to be deposited into the sports development fund.
पॉलिसी के ऊपर पॉलिसी बना रहे हैं, और ये पॉलिसी सुन के तो मतलब ऐसे लगता है कि अनपढ़ लोग बैठे हैं ऊपर, अनपढ़ लोग भी ऐसी बात नहीं करें, वो भी समझेंगे कि खिलाड़ी कितनी मेहनत करते हैं, कैसे करते हैं और कैसे वहाँ तक पहुँचते हैं।
सरकार को बस यही कहना चाहूँगा कि इस पॉलिसी को दोबारा से आप देखें और इस पर रिव्यू करें, क्योंकि आप देखोगे कि खिलाड़ी जो है सभी मध्यम परिवार से हैं।
Speak a bit more about this. I'm joined now by Ashok Khemka, Principal Secretary of Sports and Youth Affairs in Haryana. I'm also speaking with Sushil Kumar, two-time Olympic medalist and a wrestling world champion. Welcome to both of you. Sushil Kumar ji se hum pehle baat karenge. Sushil Kumar ji, shukriya humse baat karne ke liye. Aapki pratikriya kya hai is pure notification par? Pehle aaya, uska bacha hua, ab wapas le liya gaya hai?
मैं आपके
दर्शन हुए पहलवान जी, ये आपके साथ अन्याय कर रहे हैं।
बस आशीर्वाद
जी। सुशील कुमार जी,
जी जी, मैं आपके माध्यम से बस यही कहना चाहूंगा कि एक बार इस पॉलिसी पे है ना रिव्यू करना चाहिए, और जो है खिलाड़ी जो है देश का खिलाड़ी है, कहीं और का खिलाड़ी नहीं है।
आपकी आवाज साफ नहीं आ रही है सुशील कुमार जी, आप इस पॉलिसी पर क्या कहना चाहते हैं? All right, we'll try getting him back with a clearer line. I also have with me Mr. Ashok Khemka, very well-known IAS officer, known to take some tough calls. Mr. Khemka, what exactly happened here? What was the thought behind this notification?
Should I speak in English or Hindi? Because Sushil is there, so if I speak in Hindi, he will have the advantage of understanding what I say.
As you wish, sir. I need to get Sushil back on the line because I think we got okay. cut off. But please do proceed. Yes.
Okay. The background of this case was a case in the High Court of Punjab and Haryana, where there was a public interest litigation against a medalist, an Olympic boxer medalist, taking part in professional boxing. At that time, the government made a commitment to the High Court that they pleaded for protection of that medalist in favor of his playing professional boxing. And they said, we'll come out with a policy in this matter. In this regard, the case was moved to the sports department to frame a policy regarding the taking part of employee sports persons in professional sports and commercial endorsements. Now, professional sports must be seen from that angle that it is not sports playing for India or playing for the state or playing for your employer. Whatever earnings you do, when you play for India or when you play for the state, whether it is Haryana or Maharashtra or any other state, or when you play for your employer, in this case, it would be the Haryana police. Then whatever earnings you get in terms of match fee, you will be treated as duty period, and you also get cash awards. For example, the government pays up to 6 crores for winning a gold in Olympics. So it is a 6 crores plus other benefits are there, like getting plots,
okay.
etc.
No,
so many
Mr. Khemka, I got your basic point that this is for athletes and sports people who are also employed with the government. Just a couple of key things to clarify and where the contention came from, which is number one, when they make money from commercial endorsements, etc., they also pay an income tax. Does a state government have the right to impose an additional income tax, which is what this essentially is, and ask sports people to give their money from commercial endorsements to a sports fund, which is something that the state government in itself should be funding?
No, this is a wrong interpretation of the things. This is not a tax or a cess. If it is a tax or a cess, it will be by way of a statute. A government employee is governed on employment by the rules, orders of the government at that time in force. So when a employment is given to any person in the government, he simply gets an order of appointment, and whatever rules are there in force is applicable on him ipso facto. So in this case, the rules since independence across the country, it is not only in this state, across the central government and across all the states, is that a government employee cannot take up commercial employment outside the scope of his employment. So once you are employed, you cannot take up any other employment.
Sir, but I understand the rules. And of course, as a senior IAS officer, you know the rules well. But in this case, are we really to understand that sports persons who are given government jobs as a recognition of the honor they brought to their country should be treated as regular employees? What do you expect them to come to government offices and do?
If I may just complete my question.
The honor is given to them because it is recognized that as a sportsperson, they have a limited shelf life for their profession, for whatever commercials they can do, whatever endorsements they can even get. It seems a little unfair for the government to want to pull into their pockets for funds.
See, Tamannaji, just bear me out for a minute and you will get the point. If these are honorary appointments, then the sportsperson lose a very big part of their career. Now, whichever sportspersons we have appointed as deputy superintendent of police, they will move up their career as any other deputy superintendent of police, and almost all of them will become director general of police. If these are honorary appointments, they will be stuck as deputy superintendent of police throughout their lives. These are not honorary appointments, and I have fought for this very valiantly, that these are regular appointments and they will move up the normal promotional channel and become and occupy the top post of Director General of Police and move up to the Indian Police Service or to the Indian Administrative Service as any other regular entrant. So if these are honorary appointments, your point is well taken. These are not honorary appointments like what Sachin Tendulkar got. These are regular appointments and they will move up the promotion channel. For example, Sachin Tendulkar is an honorary captain in the Indian Air Force. He will not become the chief of the Air Force. He will not move up the promotion channel. These are regular government appointments. These are not honorary appointments.
Right, Mr. Kimka. Mr. Kimka, you know, we take your point there. But just to figure out how sportspersons are viewing this, and we had Sushil Kumar for a short while earlier. Now, you say that this is based on an old service rule, Rule 56.
No. But absolutely, sir.
But my question to you is that why is this rule, and why is this rule in the headlines now with the Haryana government considering it? I mean, this is a nationwide rule. Other states are not enforcing this. Why are we looking at this in Haryana per se?
See, Haryana is the first state which has moved and said we allow commercial endorsements and we allow professional sports. Now, professional sports is where a player allows himself to be bidded by a team or a club. So whoever is the highest bidder gets into place for that team or that club. So Haryana is the first state. No other state has given this concession to its sports persons. So first acknowledge that in this notification, if this empowerment was not there, an employee sports person playing for professional sports, that is allowing himself to be bidded or doing commercial advertisement, is illegal.
Okay.
It will invite disciplinary action. Right? So this is the concession which has been given to sports person, recognizing their limited shelf lives.
Okay, so clearly, from the sportsperson's point of view, the concession, as you say, has a too high a price to pay, because the government is asking for 33% of all their income from everything they do. I just have one question, sir.
No. This small correction.
Okay.
It is only from commercial endorsements and playing for professional, where you have allowed yourself to be auctioned out. Only those income, 33% to the fund, sports fund, which will be used for development of sports.
Okay. I think perhaps if it was 33% of what they earn from their government jobs, they would not be that much contention. Just my question basically is, we've seen the barrage of criticism and strong responses which have come from celebrated
sports
people.
The person you are speaking.
Why, in that case, have you decided to take back this notification or suspend it for now, Mr. Khemka?
Repeat the question.
Yes, my question to you, sir, is that you have, defended this notification, but we've seen the barrage of criticism that has come from so many sportspersons. Has that pushed the government to reconsider?
Look, I am not able to comment on that question regarding the reconsideration part, because you see, a government policy stays till it is overruled in writing through another notification. So I won't take that question, but the criticism is largely on the point of not understanding the context and not understanding that it is a concession. It is for the welfare of sportsperson, where we have regularized an activity which was not regular.
Okay.
So if they were doing commercial endorsements and were doing professional sports, that was illegal. They were retaining their income. They may as well continue it today, but if they want to regularize it so that they're tomorrow, when they grow old and they are no longer useful in sports, this complaint would spring up upon them, and they will make themselves liable for tomorrow after 10 years for unnecessary action which they wouldn't wish it today. So there are not very many sports person who are engaged in this kind of activity, maybe two or three.
Sir, just curious, Mr. Khemka, did the Haryana government consult with any sport professionals before coming out with this decision?
The part of the file is, the notice, it's not fair for me to come out and say we consulted him or consulted that.
Did you consult any sports people?
No, we do consultation. And the question is that these are normal rules of a government employee, where the minimum deduction for engaging in commercial activity is 1/3. It goes up to 60%.
All right. Should sports people be subject to the same? Well, they've said a resounding no. The Haryana government has heard it for now. Thank you so much, Ashok Khemka, for speaking with us and explaining your point of view.
Government's point of view.
The government's point of view. Well, the government's point of view right now is to put it in suspension. So I'll restrict it to your point of view as we are speaking now. But thank you so much for talking to us.
Thank you.
The debate still continues, though, whether professional athletes should be subject to these stringent rules, and are bureaucrats in the right position to decide how their salaries are used. Now, the National Stock Exchange, other big news, has put 60 companies that are under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code under additional surveillance. Sajit Manga joins us to explain the significance of this move. Sajit?
That's right. There has been a growing debate about how the stock exchanges and regulators should be looking at companies which are listed and are facing insolvency proceedings at the NCLT. And this debate has been going on for some time with the regulator and the exchanges, as per part of the surveillance mechanism, have now decided that additional surveillance measures would be undertaken for all the companies which are under insolvency at the NCLT. There are nearly 60 companies which are currently in NCLT under various stages, and all these 60 companies will fall under the ASM. As part of the ASM mechanism, there would be initial 100% margin which is required to be made by anyone who is trying to buy or sell the shares. In addition, if the need be and if the stocks volatility persists, then these companies will again be put under a severe one, which is the trade-to-trade, where there is no intraday trade allowed on these companies, and the trades are only meant for delivery based. There will be other measures which like circuit filters and all, which are existing with the stock exchange, but both for now it's 60 companies which go into the ASM as we speak.
All right, Sujit, thanks so much for that update. Now, China's decision to withdraw any financial support to new renewable power projects is expected to lead to a supply glut in equipment. And this, in turn, has prompted India to go slow on plans of setting up a solar power equipment manufacturing capacity in the country. Anindya Upadhyay of Bloomberg News sums up the development for you.
This is a classic case of timing being everything, and I'll explain how. So in the last week of May, India floated its first ever tender to set up 5 gigawatts of solar manufacturing capacity in the country. Now, just a week after this, China did a policy change, as you mentioned, and slowed down its own solar capacity expansion, which means that there's going to be an equipment oversupply, and it will cause prices to crash globally. So now India was in any case not a very competitive manufacturing destination, and India itself has been dependent for 90% of its solar power needs on Chinese imports. And the government has always kind of pointed to that as a concern. But thanks to cheap Chinese equipment that India has been able to get record low prices. Now, the moment this change happened, obviously it concerned the Indian government, who had come out with this tender and with an ambition to have a manufacturing environment and solar manufacturing in India and not be dependent on China. However, officials at the Solar Energy Corp of India, who issued this tender of inviting investors to set up manufacturing capacity in the country, also think that probably global queues may force them to delay the timing of this auction. Earlier, the government has talked about giving incentives to the solar manufacturers in the country, who are really very, very far and few, to make our product more competitive. Now, it remains to be seen if that happens in the future, because cheap supply of equipment is definitely going to exacerbate the gap between products produced in India and that available outside. So what happens with India's ambition of manufacturing 5 gigawatts of solar modules in the country really needs to be seen slowly in the course of time.
Now, Prime Minister Modi is all set to attend the two-day annual Shanghai Cooperation Summit in Qingdao starting tomorrow. The PM is likely to pitch for a concerted regional and global action against terror networks. PM Modi is also scheduled to hold a bilateral meet with Chinese President Xi Jinping on the sidelines of the summit and discuss bilateral trade ties. Modi is expected to hold nearly half a dozen bilateral meetings with leaders of other SCO countries.
The much-awaited G7 meeting begins today. Trump's decision to impose tariffs on steel and aluminium imports from the EU, Mexico and Canada, the decision to walk out of the Paris Climate Change Agreement, and the decision to exit the Iran deal are likely to be major talking points.
Other G7 leaders have already upped the ante and called upon the US to make concessions to member countries. Germany, France and Canada have been particularly specific about what they want out of the G7 meeting. And US President Donald Trump said he may sign an accord to formally end the Korean War with North Korean leader Kim Jong-un at their June 12th summit. Not just that, he raised the possibility of later hosting Kim at the White House. Trump has, however, imposed one rider on North Korea. Kevin Cirilli of Bloomberg News tells us what that is.
The president yesterday in the Rose Garden at the press conference telling us reporters that the hard work will begin, Tom, after the signing of that Korean Peninsula peace treaty that would end the Korean War. That would largely be a show of global geopolitical theatrics. But the second point that we're going to have to see here is whether or not North Korea leader Kim Jong-un directly states to President Trump that he is willing to denuclearize. Yesterday in the White House Brady press briefing room, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo Secretary Pompeo met with the North Korea leader twice already, and he said that he has been given assurances that that North Korea leader Kim Jong-un is, quote-unquote, willing to denuclearize.
So, Tamanna, it's the end of the week. What's up on Primetime Debate?
Well, we're talking about an interesting subject, Ayushree, which is the gender gap in pay. You think there should be equal pay for the same work, equal
that's
work,
right.
But that's not the case. India is particularly bad. There's government data which shows the gender pay divide and why it's so stark, no matter if you're a graduate, a top management or illiterate. If you're a woman, you're going to get paid less. We're going to talk a bit more about that. Rituparna Chakravarti of Team Lee's, Sai Chahal of Shiro's and Prachi Salvi of India Spend is going to join us on that discussion. Stay tuned.